up at RBC. You're about to watch our next bottle review. If you guys love this content like we do, please like and subscribe us.
The soil is made up of silt and clay and loam, and what you really want is a combination of all three of those components, but it all goes into making bourbon. It starts with the corn growing in the soil and the barley and the wheat and the rye, but then also the oak trees like we have across the road here to make the barrels. Really, everything about bourbon comes from the soil.
This is the story of grains, water, and wood. It's the story of immigrants and farmers and businessmen and criminals. The story of cold winters and hot summers. It's the story of time. This is the story of bourbon.
Two things are important. The first is you never bring out old aged bourbons until you're with friends and family and you're not in any hurry to go anywhere.
It's all about the earth and the soil and the natural ingredients that go in to make it, because bourbon is an all natural product. There's nothing synthetic about it.
America's only native spirit is so big and so beautiful that it can handle anything you want to throw at it and still give you the true character that's in that glass.
Bourbon heritage is American heritage. Every phase of American history is reflected through bourbon history.
It's not grabbing a bottle of beer out of a cooler. It's, let me pour you a glass of this. Let me tell you where this came from. Let me tell you the story on this. It's history in a glass.
I think people have discovered that bourbon is not just a shot in a beer. It's amazing to see it, because I mean, it's not just your granddad's drink or your dad's drink like it used to be when I was young.
If you like the idea of going to the horse races and living kind of an agrarian type of life, bourbon sort of gives you a way to live in central Kentucky just for a moment in your life, whether you're actually there or not.
It's almost like a legacy that says, if time was not a factor in our lives, bourbon could transport us back into some of those places where maybe life was a lot easier going. That's what bourbon's all about.
Whoever came over on the Mayflower brought a still with them. And whoever came over the Appalachian Mountains to settle Kentucky first brought a still with them. Whiskey was much, much more than just a drink.
Distilling was a way of life. It was what you did with your surplus corn. If you store corn, it could rot. It could get eaten by mice or other vermin. You turn into a bottle of whiskey, it's going to stay that bottle of whiskey. It's going to be good then. Or forever.
They didn't have refrigeration like we have it today. They didn't have, you know, the canning technology that we have today. So one of the best ways to preserve your corn was to turn it into whiskey.
In Scotland and Ireland and England, if you grew more corn than you could use for your family, it belonged to the king. But in the New World, if you grew more corn than you could use for your family, you got to choose what you did with it. And what did they do? they made whiskey that was very much like moonshine. It was kind of a rough cut, not the, you know, very elegant spirit that we make today.
It was thought to be medicinal. And you remember, you're on the frontier. There's not a drugstore to go to.
You got to remember, these are frontiersmen. They work from sun up to sun down. You get up in the morning, you're still aching from the day before, so you have a little eye opener, a drink of whiskey to get you going. A lot of people don't realize that that's where the mint julep comes from. It was a breakfast drink.
Whiskey was used as a medium of exchange. You would first grow enough corn to feed your family and your livestock. Whatever you had left over, you either carried around large bushel baskets of corn or you distilled it.
Whiskey was just a very important part of that life. So when the frontiersmen came into the New West, you know, you got to realize Kentucky is the first American West. A lot of people brought stills.
They weren't whiskey folks. They were architects. They were structural engineers. They were chemists. They were biochemists. It's not about the whiskey. It's about the people that make the product so cool.
Now, before going any further, we need to answer a very simple question. What does it take for a spirit to be able to call itself bourbon?
Bourbon is the most heavily regulated product in the world. Our federal government tells you how you have to make bourbon.
I think the first thing to understand is all bourbon is whiskey, but not all whiskey is bourbon. By definition, whiskey is a grain-based distillate. Once you understand that bourbon is a whiskey, then it's what defines a bourbon. So the rules of bourbon, I call it the ABCs. You start with A, American made.
Bourbon is uniquely American because you can only make it in America. You can distill 51% corn, age it in new charred oak barrels. You can jump through all those hoops, but if you do it in Mexico, you can't use the term bourbon.
It does not have to be made in Kentucky. A lot of folks believe that bourbon can only be made in Kentucky. Bourbon, by act of Congress, can be made anywhere in the United States.
B barrels.
It must be aged in a brand new charred white oak barrel, just like what's behind me.
The lead character of a bourbon whiskey is the use of a new charred barrel. That gives bourbon that big, rich caramel vanilla note that just makes bourbon so special.
C is corn.
To be a bourbon, you have to use at least 51% corn. There's a very good reason for that. Corn imparts a very unique flavor to bourbon, and that's sweetness. If you taste a Scotch whiskey, an Irish whiskey, you get some sweetness, a lot of it from the wood, maybe a little bit from the grains. But if you taste bourbon, you can taste that sweetness. You can almost taste the corn.
D is distillation proof. So when you come off the still, you cannot be higher than 160 proof.
The higher the proof, the less flavor that's going to be there. Think about it. Vodka is 190 proof, 192 proof when it comes off those stills. It has no flavor. It's just pure alcohol.
You start getting over 160, you're stripping out grain flavor. You're moving more into a vodka category. That's not what we want with bourbon. We want to hold on to the grain character. So one of the rules is you got to be 160 or less coming off the still. E, entry proof, going into the barrel, you have to be 125 proof or less. F, fill proof, in the bottle, your proof has to be 80 or above. G, genuine.
There are no additives allowed. So everything is what Mother Nature provides.
No flavor or no color or nothing can be added to bourbon. It's a natural product. If you add any color or any flavor, it becomes a whiskey. All that color must come from aging that new charred oak barrel.
You're only as good as what comes off the still and what comes out of that barrel and goes down that bottling line.
Okay, quiz time. Who was the first person who took that unaged white whiskey and turned it into the bourbon that we know today? In the 1800s, a Baptist minister by the name of Elijah Craig used old barrels previously containing fish and pickles to store some of his newly distilled whiskey. But in order to get rid of that nasty fish smell, he charred the inside of the barrels, making a discovery that would forever change the history of bourbon. Or, wait, maybe it was the poor farmer from Bourbon County, Kentucky, who after his barn burned down, he was forced to use some surviving but very charred barrels to transport his whiskey down the Mississippi to New Orleans, sloshing around. Or wait, maybe it was the Lexington grocer,
upon seeing the popularity of cognac, a spirit aged in toasted oak casks, put an order in for his usual corn whiskey, but this time, however, he requested that it be sent in barrels burnt upon the inside.
That's it.
Or maybe it doesn't really matter. Somehow, bourbon found a way.
We are on our way to Walnut Grove Farm, and we're actually headed to the home farm, which is where their family first settled back in the 1800s, which is incredible. They're going to be providing all of the corn for my bourbon.
This is Marianne Barnes, and she is the first female master distiller since Prohibition. This is also the Marianne Barnes that Forbes magazine named one of the top 30 business people under 30 years old. In 2015, Marianne and her business partners launched a brand new distillery called Castle and Key, setting up shop in the long abandoned Old Taylor Distillery. Today, she's come to the Kentucky-Tennessee border to get some corn for her first batch of bourbon.
Corn is a historical ingredient for bourbon. It goes back to the roots of when bourbon started in Kentucky.
When the settlers first came out here, they were still making rye and barley whiskeys. When they hit this part of the United States, they encountered the Indians. The Indians had been exposed to the Spanish. The Spanish had introduced the Indians to corn whiskey, moonshine. And what they did was they started mixing corn whiskey with the rye and barley whiskeys, and that's how the taste of bourbon got started.
By law, your bourbon has to be at least 51% corn. It is the most important ingredient. It's the star of the show. You're getting a lot of your flavor from your corn, not only just because it's that percentage, but it's a very flavorful grain.
Corn actually identifies bourbon because of the flavor that it imparts. If you taste any whiskeys the world over, you'll notice that bourbon is very unique, especially in its sweetness. And that is derived from the corn that is used to make it.
That corn is what's going to give it a lot of sweetness. A lot of the mouthfeel is going to come from the corn. And so you deliberately bring bourbon off the still at a lower proof. And that retains some of the natural properties of it.
It's just a very robust flavor. And what that does is it can go through maturation. It can go to the barrel. And so it's going to come through, whether it's 4 years old or 23 years old. Corn really does last, you know, over those years. And you can still get it, you know, 18 or 23 years later.
In a single bottle of bourbon, depending on your recipe, you'll have somewhere between 2 and 2.5 pounds of corn. It's really important to take care of the soil and nourish the soil that's going to feed the plants that eventually go into bourbon. You know, corn grows for 4 months and it's pulling from the earth. The oak trees that eventually go into the barrels that are going to contain your product for 4 years have been drawing from the earth for upwards of 40, 50 years. Every season that is come and gone, every change in the environment, you'll eventually taste in a glass of bourbon. In a lot of ways, it's like drinking history and experiencing nature in a completely different way.
There's a lot of science involved in anything that you do in farming. But once you get past the science, there's still an art, just like anything else, just like fine furniture. The guy that's making the furniture knows he can look at the grain of the wood and know which way it needs to be put together to make a beautiful piece. And farming's the same way. You have the craftsmanship that really is just, you just gain over a lifetime.
There are always an even number of rows per ear. And in this case, these are 14 around. In other years, we sometimes see as many as 16 or 18. And I think it's because we had an excess of water this year that we actually has hurt our yields a little bit. They'll still be above average yields.
You can tell how many bushels you're going to yield per acre.
You can make That's a pretty good estimate.
We're sitting next to a field of non-GMO white corn that has been grown specifically for our Bottled and Bond Core bourbon brand. in 4 years, this 45 acres of white corn will be about 250,000 bottles of bourbon.
We encourage people to take pictures. We encourage them to ask questions. It's a touchy-feely tour. We tell them to touch the barrels, you know, kind of look at it. When we're going to the bottling house, you'll get a chance to hold a bottle and kind of like take some, you know, some special photos. Come over this way. Let's head this way.
You've already met Freddie Johnson. Now, what he hasn't told you is that he's a third-generation employee at the Buffalo Trace Distillery. His grandfather worked here, his father worked here, and now he works here. Trust me when I say, this guy knows bourbon, and today he's agreed to teach us a thing or two about the art of tasting.
Well, we've had a chance to look around the distillery, and now it's the time that you've really been waiting for, and that is to see what that product is going to taste like after it's been in the barrel for a while. This is your White Dog, Everclear, Georgia Moon, White Lightning, and this is what goes into the barrel, and this is what the settlers used to drink back in the day. Got it? Word on the street, if you haven't been dead more than 2 weeks, this will bring you back. Okay, now, you're going to cup your hand like this. I want you to smell of it. You'll notice it smells very soft and buttery to the nose. Now, I want you to smack your hands together. Smack them. Rub them real briskly. Now, cup and smell them again. Really strong of alcohol now, right? So now the dog is awake, okay? All right. I know the strength of this whiskey. Let them breathe. Let them breathe, all right? When I say Hillshire, you say farm. When I say bourbon, you say corn. Smack your hands again. Rub them real briskly. Cup, smell them again. Corn. How about that? What's the dominant grade in bourbon? Dottie?
Corn.
Exactly. And if this had been straight rye whiskey, it would have smelled like rye. If it had been scotch, it would have smelled like barley. I now know the strength of your whiskey and the dominant grain you've used to make it with. Let them breathe again. Fly, my friends. Be free. Let them breathe. Smack them again. Rub them real briskly. Cup. Smell them again. Now they smell like bread, like yeast. So now I know the strength, I know the dominant grain, and I know the kind of yeast that you use. So that's the way the old moonshiners found out about whiskey before they ever let it touch their lips. Cool?
We talked about this. It's going to hurt you every time you bark. I know this hurts you. That last one was, okay, I'm done. This hurts.
That guy who hates dogs so much is named Paul Steele, and he lives in Nashville, Tennessee. Paul's into bourbon, really into bourbon. So much so that he decided to turn his basement into a speakeasy.
It escalated really quickly. We moved into the house about 3.5 years ago, and this was just an unfinished basement. And then my wife's father got ill, and he passed away relatively quickly.
So we acquired a bunch of family pieces from my dad and Paul's grandparents as a way to honor them and kind of hang on to those memories. We were able to keep some stuff, and that's the only place we had room for it was our basement.
This is his. This light is his. He was a metal worker. He made these. Like, most of the stuff on the walls are from his bar. And that made it take shape really, really quickly.
In that first year, Paul's bourbon collection went from a single fifth of Jefferson's to 370 unique bottles. This, along with the regular tastings that he hosts, has made Paul a bit of a folk hero among aficionados.
So tonight we are having a little, more or less, party get together, celebration of life. That sounds like someone died. No one died. We are having a little party at the speakeasy. We do this probably 3 times a year. They've got a great selection. I mean, it's not a huge store, but I think this is the only place in Nashville that sells Heaven Hill. I like the gallon. Sometimes they have stuff in the back. Might be worth asking about. Is that all the bourbon you got, or you might have more in the back? What she is this the 22 or the? Yep, 22. I will definitely be picking this up. Yeah, so I am very happy. I'm picking up the limited edition Four Roses Elliott Select.
We always hire a bartender to work all of our parties, and typically it's just kind of your normal bartender, but this time we were like, we want the mixologist of Nashville. And so we were just kind of looking around and researching and finding out who that might be. We found some stuff online about this guy named Jonathan Howard. Paul ended up finding him on Instagram, I think. He came up with some special drinks to make for us tonight.
I'm making a drink, especially with bourbon, I think there's a lot more that is to be said to the spirit than just stirring it in an old fashioned or stirring it in a Manhattan. Both beautiful drinks, but I like a Gold Rush, you know, honey, which is going to bring out some of that, you know, some of the honey qualities of the whiskey because they are there. And then lemon juice and just something that's really easy and good to drink. And they're just balanced. They're really pretty. You know, I like drinks like that. I like taking sort of the spirit, no matter what it is, and saying, okay, this is what's always done with it. I'd rather do this.
Bourbon is much needed in today's climate. Everyone is always busy. If you ask how someone is doing, good but busy. And because bourbon is not meant to be shot, you know, it's meant to be enjoyed, I think bourbon is going against the grain of society and returning to where we all come from. So I just think intrinsically bourbon is a great pause button. And that to me is direly needed in today's current climate.
I'm Elon Musk, and I'm making cocktails at Inateca in Lexington, Kentucky today. I'm Seth Brewer, and I'm making a cocktail for you all at Inateca in Lexington, Kentucky. Today we are making the Winner's Circle. It is a Maker's Mark cocktail. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna pour in one jigger of our Maker's Mark. You're then going to use 3/4 of an ounce of Gents ginger syrup from here in Lexington, 3/4 Jack Rudy elderflower tonic, and 3/4 Giffard Pamplemousse Rosé pink grapefruit liqueur. It's a little shake, and we will top with a Bing cherry that has been marinated in that same Giffard Pamplemousse pink grapefruit liqueur. And there you have a winner's circle.
After the Civil War, bourbon was hot. The peace dividend was paying off. People wanted to enjoy distilled spirits. The opportunity was so good that you had people come to the table that wanted to shortcut the whole system. They didn't want to build a distillery and sit on the stuff for a couple of years, or they wanted to make a quick buck.
You didn't really know where your whiskey was coming from or who made it or who might have tampered with it before you tasted it, before you went to the bar and got a drink, or before your doctor prescribed it to you.
Bourbon was in such a high demand that there were these rectifiers who were making bourbon overnight.
They'd add either neutral spirits or they'd add rubbing alcohol or water. And since the color was lighter, they might put a little tobacco spit in there to get the color back up. Maybe the bite wasn't there, so they'd add just acid to it.
They would look the same to the naked eye. And the packaging sort of betrayed that trust, really. That original social contract of what I put on this label is what is in this bottle was being broken.
People were literally dying. That's where the name gut drink comes from, was that rectifier era.
To the consumer, they would go in and they would see 2 bottles of bourbon. One would be authentically produced according to standards that are more or less the same as how we make bourbon today. The other was bogus, hocus pocus. It could be neutral grain spirit with food coloring and sugar. That started to tarnish the reputation of whiskey.
Colonel Taylor was a banker from Frankfort, Kentucky, who eventually got into distilling. And anything he did first class. He was very proud of what the distillery looked like, very proud of the product he made, and he wanted to make sure that that product got to the consumer.
In 1887, Colonel Taylor built a limestone castle to house his distillery. In a way, it symbolized protection for his bourbon from an industry that people back then really couldn't trust. So he worked for 10 years on the Bottle and Bond Act of 1897.
Bottle and Bond Act was the first truth in advertising law in the United States. Now think about that. Didn't start with food, didn't start with medicine, didn't start with fuel. It started with whiskey.
He brought trust and transparency and authenticity and that respect and that relationship between the consumer and the distiller.
This was a revolutionary moment. After the Bottle and Bond Act was passed, consumers could walk into the store, pick up a bottle, see Bottle and Bond on the label, and they would be assured of the quality that they were getting. And this changed the story of bourbon forever.
What does it take for a bourbon to be considered bottled in bond? Well, a couple things, but first, I want to shout out to Colonel Taylor. I love what you did with the law. Okay. Bottled in bond. Couple things. First, the whiskey must be the product of one distillation season, one master distiller, and one distillery. Second, it must be aged in a federally bonded warehouse under U.S. government supervision for at least 4 years. And third, it must be bottled in glass at 100 proof, like you're going to put it in a plastic bottle. So next time you're at the liquor store, grab yourself a bottle of bonded bourbon and rest assured you get the real deal. Like, you think, is this bonded bourbon? No. This is in plastic.
Hey, Petey, you gonna say hi? No, you're not gonna say hi today. All right. Petey is a blue-fronted Amazon. We've just acquired him recently. His longtime owner passed away last year. And birds live to be about 70 years old, so Petey's about 35, and we'll have him for the rest of his life.
This is Nick Laraquante, and he's an archaeologist. No, he doesn't have a fedora, but he does have a parrot, and a snake that he's not crazy about named, of all things, Gabriel.
Him and I, we don't get along too well. I married into him.
But he does love bourbon. So much so that he and a team of volunteers spend their nights and weekends scouring the woods of Kentucky looking for what remains of some of the nation's first distilleries. And what they found thus far has been pretty amazing. In October of 2016, Nick and his comrades helped unearth what some have dubbed the Bourbon Pompeii, long-forgotten fermenting vats at the Buffalo Trace Distillery, dating back to 1873. Today, they're heading out to a new site, and they've invited us to come along.
Today, we're heading out to the Fraser Distillery. It's an industrial distillery in Woodford County, built around 1860-ish, I believe, and burnt down about 1908, and was rebuilt just in time for Prohibition. And around Prohibition, I think it just went out of business. Maybe it was salvaged for parts, but this is only our second day out there. So let's stage the equipment over in this area. Put all the tarps and equipment and stuff in here. Let me get Carl kind of situated and we're gonna let him just run with it. You're probably gonna hit a lot of rock right in here.
All right.
Because there is a remnants of a stone wall there. Okay. And it looks like it might have run up even with this thing.
And so we are inside.
Inside.
All right.
We're underneath the mashing floor right
all
now.
Right.
Fermenting vats would have been over there.
Okay.
Still would have been over there.
Okay.
And don't know how it changed over time.
I'm going to be down at the end that way.
Yeah. Oh, this is just another piece of this metal scrap, it looks like, here. Piece of bark?
We found bark, yes. And a little piece of brick.
Oh, look at that.
Coal.
Yep. So a piece of coal.
That's a good thing.
That's a good thing. As they're using coal to run the boilers, which are right back here. Yeah.
As we went down and we started examining an area, we noticed a lot of charcoal, likely from the burning of the distillery. And then we saw that, and it's like, that looks odd. It's nice, rounded shape. And as I looked at it, corn has that little distinctive dent in there, and all of a sudden, it's like, oh, we've got corn. My eyes got wide. My hair stood up on end, and I yelled, Nick!
How old are we talking?
This is from the distillery fire. That was what, 1908.
Mm-hmm.
So just a little over 100 years.
Okay, so they found some bricks, a couple of nails, and a piece of corn. Not quite the lost ark you think of when you hear the word archaeologist. But maybe the story of bourbon isn't all glamorous. Sometimes it's just regular people working really hard on something they really love. That's kind of cool. Every day, thousands upon thousands of pounds of grain roll into distilleries all across Kentucky. This is Brian, and he inspects every load of grain that comes into the Four Roses Distillery by hand. Or more accurately, by nose.
Every load that comes in here is smelt of before it's ever unloaded. Always. That's the very first thing. If it doesn't pass that, then there's no sense in running any of the rest of it.
So here's the question. After Brian ensures that the grains are free of mold and moisture, how do they become bourbon?
These are the three grains that we use to produce Four Roses. Of course, we have the corn, rye, and the malted barley. And this is what it looks like when it's milled down. We use the corn for the sweetness, the rye for the nice, spicy, structured flavors. The malted barley imparts maybe a little bit of flavor, but we use this primarily for the enzymes that are inside the malted barley. From here, they go into the masher, and the mash begins.
A mash bill is simply your recipe. What are the ingredients you're going to use, and at what percentage are you going to use those in order to make your whiskey?
This is our cooker, and this is where the mashing process takes place. We're taking all the grains that are in the process. We're adding the heat and the water to gelatinize all the starches within the grains so that the yeast can come in and ferment the sugars that are inside the grains. This is the fermenter room. The fermenters, that's where the magic kind of happens. After the mashing, we send that to a drop tub. It gets cooled, sent to the fermenters, and then we inoculate it with the yeast.
The role of yeast in the bourbon making process is pretty simple. We've converted starch to sugar during the mashing process, and then the yeast eats the sugar and produces alcohol.
We've hand selected five different strains of yeast that each creates its own different flavors. Some create spicy flavors, some create fruity, some create floral, some herbal. So each one of these yeasts creates different flavors through fermentation based on its strain.
This is our column still. It's made of pure copper. It's 4 feet in diameter, 45 feet tall. This is where all the distillation happens.
We do a double distillation, which is pretty common for most people. And at the first distillation is it's solid separation. So you want to separate out all the grain from that alcohol water mix.
As you may or may not know, alcohol comes to a boil at a much lower temperature than water. So to separate the alcohol from the mash, distillers heat the mash in the still, and the alcohol is volatilized. aka turn to steam. As the alcoholic vapor rises, it's captured, and when it cools, it condenses back into a liquid. It's then distilled a second time, purifying it even further.
And this is Distillate or White Dog. This is the final product. This is about 140 proof. What we'll do now is we'll ship this off to our warehousing facility. It'll be cut to 120 proof and put in the barrel. In 5 years, this will be bourbon.
If you come to this whiskey business in your early 20s, and with everything you know about making whiskey, you make the very best batch of whiskey you know how to make. Everything that you've learned, your family has been able to share, you make that batch of whiskey, you're going to release expressions of it. But when your last barrel from that batch reaches its maturity, you're now 45 years old, and that was your first batch. So you make another batch based on everything you learned from your first batch. By the time you go through that process again and your last barrel reaches its maturity, you're about 75 years old. In this industry, what most people don't realize, it is very, very rare that an old whiskey guy like us ever gets to taste their third batch to its final maturity. That's the legacy you leave for the next generation. You get to think about that. You're thinking, I'm tasting what they didn't get a chance to taste.
So here's the deal. Water is your friend, okay? Limestone water has a special property. It has a lot of calcium, a lot of minerals in it. When the water passes through this limestone, it filters out the iron, which is really gives whiskey a bad taste. So it's a little bit softer and sweeter, okay? You got that in one hand, and this is your Buffalo Trace. Now, here's what we're gonna do. So you've had a chance to play around with the White Dog. So you've already gotten acclimated to the smell and what the White Dog is all about. So now we're gonna let our palate take over after this White Dog has been in the barrel for a while. So what I want you to do for me is I want you to take a sip of the water first. Now take a tiny sip of your Buffalo Trace. Just a little tiny sip of the Buffalo Trace. Now come right back with the water again. But this time, Doc, hold a little bit of the water in your mouth, okay? And with the water in your mouth, take another sip of that same Buffalo Trace with the water in your mouth. And just roll it around on your tongue for a little bit, okay? And all of a sudden you realize, whoa, I can taste a little bit of the char, a little bit of an oaky, woody kind of a taste profile to it. And a little bit of an alcohol burn, but the finish is kind of smooth. And each time you go back for your next sip, reduce the amount of water that you're holding in your mouth. And gradually you get acclimated down to neat, straight up. But that allows you to understand how much of a dilution do I want with this bourbon to enjoy the flavors that I enjoy. So in the industry, there is no right or wrong way to drink bourbon, whether it's a flick of water, two flicks of water, one ice cube, two ice cube, chilled, poured over ice, okay? Crushed ice. All those things are components in releasing different flavors to the bourbon. Cool? All right, so the right way to drink bourbon is just the way you like it. All right.
My name's Jake Solick. I'm a bartender here at OBC. Today I'm gonna be making a smoked old fashioned. We're using two dashes of a homemade Abbott's bitters, two dashes of a Fee Brothers cherry bitter. Then we're gonna sweeten this with what's called a fall simple syrup. It's a traditional simple syrup. It's infused with cinnamon, apple peels, and allspice. 2 ounces of your bourbon. This is a mix of wood chips and barrel char. And we've got a smoked old fashioned.
There is a slaughterhouse right there. And when the wind catches it just right, it's like a cloud of death coming over you. Oh, and at night you drive by, you can hear them squealing. Yeah, it's like.
I'd like to introduce you to Jackie Zeichen, Master Bourbon Specialist for Old Forester, which is a fancy way of saying she gets paid to enjoy bourbon. She's agreed to take us out and show us some of the sights and sounds of Louisville, Kentucky. Our first stop, a little haunt known as Old Town Liquors.
Hey, what's up?
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you. Do you have something new?
I do. We've got this Maker's Barrel Pick. So we tried to blend some staves where we got a whiskey that was kind of like an old style whiskey, real caramelly, chocolatey.
It's like if you only ate the outside layers of a Milky Way. I'm sorry. Always a sniff first. It's not like wine. You're not like all up in it. Your mouth open, in through your nose, in your mouth. Set this on your top lip. Give yourself a little tasting glass mustache, like, and you breathe it in, and then you get everything except the burn. If you do it straight on, you're going to fry your nose out, and you're not going to smell anything. And then you taste. And then you taste again, because the first taste, no matter how good the whiskey, always tastes like gasoline. It always does. It's always intense.
Hey, Jim. Let's see. Stashed back here is E.H. Taylor's Seasoned Wood.
I'm going to invent the disposable Glencairn tasting glass.
Are you?
I am.
Don't.
Yes, sir. Man, this is going to be a really weird one. Hey.
I'll give you that.
Is there a weird hey going on? Hey. It sounded so bad. Thank you.
You bet. Take care.
We're at Butchertown Grocery in a little neighborhood called Butchertown. It's just outside of downtown Louisville. We're going to stop in and say hi to my friend Kyle. He's a bartender here. He's one of the best in the city. Kyle Higgins, how are you?
Good. Good to see you.
Cocktails?
Of course.
Yes.
Looks like okay. Cocktail list?
Yes.
Well, bourbon is, you know, rich. There's a lot of depth that goes into bourbon cocktails. And there are so many different ways that you can play off that.
Yeah, there's a whole different complexity because you're starting with something that already has a diverse flavor going on and you're playing that up. You're trying to accentuate. You're trying to wear a green tie with a pink shirt because it makes the shirt look pinker. You're not trying to put on a pink shirt on top of a pink shirt kind of thing. You're not trying to cover it up. You're saying, okay, well, bourbon's got vanilla. What goes with vanilla? You're pairing off of flavors that are already in the glass. It's perfect. It's my joyful tear spritz garnish.
We ended the night at a place called Meta, and they're famous for Jello shots, but not just any Jello shots.
So originally, the idea for doing fancy Jello shots actually came like just as a pure idea. At the same time, I'm like trying to get my hands on Pappy. So I was like getting really angry and I was like, I'm tired of people coming in here and asking for it. If I get this stuff, I'm making Jello shots. And then we got it. And I was like, well, I said I would. So I did. You got to take your.
Yeah. You got to do the whole pinkies out. You
ready for this?
Yeah, I think so.
Here's how you do it. It's great though, right?
Yeah, it's so good. Dude.
I just don't think that bourbon is about sitting around like you're drinking like really crazy overage stuff that people sit in a boardroom and talk about. Bourbon really tops out at its best at around 12 years old. Bourbon has always been about fellowship, and I feel like not only when you age it do you degrade the spirit in terms of quality, but I think that you degrade the fellowship because you lose that opportunity to share it with people. Bourbon is about being with people that you care about and having fun. And it's a little bit about love. That's what bourbon is to me.
When you order a bourbon neat, you're asking for it in its purest form. Room temperature, no ice, no mixers, completely undiluted. Now, you might like the thought of this, but if it's just a little strong at first, don't be afraid to add a few drops of water. This will help open up some of the flavors and smooth out some of the rough edges. And don't worry about ruining anything. Your bourbon is bold enough to handle whatever you throw at it.
So we've already heard about the Bottle and Bond Act of 1897 And for the next 20 years, bourbon thrived in America. But then Prohibition came along and almost killed the industry. However, bourbon is resilient, and it survived. In 1933, Prohibition was repealed, and for the next 30 years, the industry rebuilt itself. And once again, boomed in America.
So let's fast forward. It's 1964, and this is an enormous year for bourbon. It's finally recognized by the federal government as America's native spirit. You can only make bourbon in the United States. Bourbon now has an identity. You know, after 1964, we know where all bourbon comes from. This is a watershed year for bourbon.
There were huge distilleries pumping out an immense amount of product. But after the revolution that the United States had in the 60s, the younger generation did not want to do what their parents had done.
Amidst the backdrop of the 1960s, you had shifting cultural preferences. People didn't want to drink what their dad drank. People wanted to do something different from what the previous generation had done. Bourbon's not cool anymore.
And they found vodka, and they found beer, and they found wine. The bars, they want to find what's hot and what's not. And so you saw in the big markets a lot of martini bars. You know, you saw commercials on TV in the 80s. I remember two old guys sitting on a porch drinking a wine cooler.
There are many ways to use the Bartles and James premium wine cooler. One lady in Massachusetts even uses it to make bread.
Outside of Kentucky, people didn't know what bourbon was. I'd go to New York, San Francisco, you looked on the shelf, there were no bourbons on the shelf.
The bourbon industry tried to adapt in the sense that they wanted to make a spirit that looked more like what consumers wanted, a clear spirit, a tequila, a vodka, or a gin. They tried to make light whiskey.
So they would take this beautifully aged, you know, 4 to 6 to 8 year old bourbon, and then they would filter it to the point where it was clear because they were trying to make it more attractive to this consumer who wanted a clear spirit. But what they did was strip out everything that was good about it. It was a futile effort. There was nothing that they could do to attract the consumer to bourbon. So distillery after distillery started to close. It was really a sad time for the industry.
There were a number of excellent distilleries that were sold to large conglomerates who simply closed the distillery. Many, many wonderful brands disappeared and will never return.
The bourbon industry was considered the old folks' drink, and clear liquids, the vodkas and the rums and the cocktails and all that had come into vogue. And what happened was, these old distilleries had thousands and thousands of barrels of bourbon just sitting around. There was no demand for them. So they just sat quietly aging in the warehouses. When I got out of school in the 60s, the bourbon industry was dead, so I moved away. I got recruited by another company, and that was my life, okay? So I was in operations and engineering and did a bunch of pretty cool stuff. And my dad was so proud, but he also wished that I'd worked at this distillery. He calls me up one day and he says, I got some good news and some bad news. And I said, well, okay, Dad. I said, well, what's the good news first? And he said, well, the good news is I love you. So I said, all right, Dad. I said, what's going on? He says, well, I'm terminally ill. And he says, I'm asking if you will keep your promise and take care of me. And what he was really asking me to do was come home. But during that period of time was when he said he wanted me to start working down here. And I didn't realize the significance of it until he started coming down here and he started talking to me. And we would do a toast every day I came in from this distillery. We would do a toast, thanking the Lord for another day together to share things. And he would come down here with me sometimes and he'd say, now, did I tell you about this? And don't forget this. And how about this? And remember this. And I realized it's more than me coming back here and just working at the distillery. He was passing all this information on. So when you're tasting really good bourbon and you just let it linger on your palate, you appreciate how it got there. And it's not just grains and a piece of wood. It's the care that make it taste like it does. Thank you.
are 286 barrels on the truck. So what we're going to do is we're inspecting those barrels. We're looking for any defects in that barrel. Most people don't realize the shape of a barrel has absolutely nothing at all to do with the aging of bourbon. It's just so you can move it around. Full of whiskey, it weighs 550 pounds.
50 to 70% of the taste of what's in the bottle comes from the barrel, and that'll depend on how you distill it, what your barrel entry proof is, what your grain recipe is, how flavorful the distillate is before it goes in. So it's somewhere between 50 and 70%.
A newly charred white oak barrel traditionally is going to be about 70 to 100 years old. White oak tree is to bourbon what a grapevine is to wine, what peat is to scotch. It's where your tree grows for those 70 to 100 years that the roots are busy picking up flavors from whatever grew around the base of that tree. So the soil, clay, decomposing foliage and vegetation are all factors in that taste profile of the barrel. When a cooper builds a barrel, it's not just a barrel. There's 30 to 33 stages in the making of a barrel. So theoretically, you could have 33 different trees in the making of that barrel. So it's more than just a barrel, because each one of those staves brings a component to the taste profile of that product.
We use the best white oak logs we can find on the market. All of those white oak logs are processed at our individual stave mills, so we're able to control the quality of that. When it gets to our facility, we raise all the barrels on our own. We own our own cooperages, so we can do some unique things here. One of those unique things is we toast every single barrel. So every single barrel is put on a high radiant heat, attracts all of those flavors to the inner part of the barrel where the whiskey or bourbon's gonna touch. From there, it's gonna go over to the char fire. And at the char fire, that's where it's actually caramelizing those flavors that were brought to the surface.
The char allows the whiskey to get into the barrel staves, and that's where those flavors are. The longer it's in that barrel, the more those flavors it's picking up.
I believe the maturation is really the magical part. It's the one part that you can't honestly control. It just happens how nature wants it to.
Bourbon takes time. You don't make it today and sell it tomorrow. You know, you gotta put it in the barrel, let nature take over. Hot summers, cold winters. You need both. Hot summers, the whiskey expands, goes into the wood. In the wintertime, when it gets cold, it contracts and comes out. That's where we get all the color and a lot of the flavor. So that's where you gotta be patient. You gotta leave it alone, put it away in the rack house, and let nature take over.
You can hold a 18, 16 year old scotch up against a 10 year old bourbon any day of the week because of some of the climate effects that we have here.
Folks are familiar with scotches that may be 30, 40 years old, but there's a huge difference in aging in Kentucky versus aging in Scotland.
If any of y'all have ever been to Scotland, you will have noticed that the weather is uniformly dreadful, which uniform is what I want to emphasize. Scotland sits in the middle of the North Sea, washed by the Gulf Stream. Weather doesn't move around a lot. Here, the jet stream swings over and above Kentucky, so we get extreme weather conditions. Those weather conditions allow the shrinkage and expansion of the liquid and the barrel, which marries the barrel to the liquid and ages the whiskey. So it's an ideal environment.
These old warehouses are like golf clubs or tennis rackets. They have sweet spots. And when the settlers first built old warehouses like this, they understood the rotation of the earth. They understood basically temperature variations and the effects that would have on whiskey, the effects of sunlight on the barrels, things like that. And so when they built these things, they knew exactly what they were doing. So when you go into these warehouses and you start pulling samples from the different barrels in different areas, you will stumble upon barrels that produce exceptionally smooth, sweet flavors.
This is bourbon before it becomes bourbon. This is the white dog before it is aged in barrels. And that is bourbon. After the aging, that's what you get. It's picked up the influence of those caramelized sugars, and it's picked up all those beautiful brown colors from the barrel, all those flavors that we associate with bourbon.
You can't control the seasons. You can't control how long the summer is or how hot it gets outside. The nature, the composition of the wood, from tree to tree, it's not gonna be the same. From season to season, it's not gonna be the same. So each individual barrel is gonna have an individual character, and I think that's pretty magical.
Don't anybody look into the bright light. That's all I gotta say. I don't need a glove, I'm good.
This is Jason Cohn, and this is his father-in-law, Jerry. Jason's a furniture maker, and his medium is used bourbon barrels.
White oak is one of the hardest woods out there. Every piece of the barrel, I think there's anywhere from 34 to 7 pieces in a barrel, are all gonna be a different size. Even though it might look the same, you put two pieces next to each other and they're gonna have a different curve, they're gonna have a different width. So trying to make things with that is extremely challenging. Nothing's ever the same, but it also makes it extremely exciting.
This is a mannequin for a liquor company made out of barrel staves and metal.
I've always liked to fix things. I was broken when I was 15. I was in a car accident. Wasn't wearing my seatbelt with your dad. Like, you know, back then nobody did in the 80s, really. And we got in a car accident and I fell out of the window and ruined the use of my left hand. And this girl I was dating looked at my hands and said, you're never gonna work with your hands. You're never gonna be anybody. And it just all of a sudden clicked one day, I need to do something. And so ever since then, I've always wanted just to fix things. So I started fixing chairs and bought a lathe and started turning stuff. And then I ran into some guy who made soy sauce and bourbon barrels, and that was it. I had to make stuff out of these recycled barrels that he kept throwing away. There's a nice line here, another line here. Here, that's the actual penetration of the bourbon into the wood. I mean, that's half the way in to an inch and an eighth stave. So it really is taking what's in the wood out into the bourbon. My life needed fixing, and this is what repaired me, was woodworking. I was broken, and these things were broken too, and now I'm putting them together in their new form, and now they're beautiful again. Thank you.
While bourbon is aging in a barrel, moving in and out of the staves during the different seasons, distillers lose 3% of their whiskey to evaporation each year. This loss of volume is known as the Angel's share. So think about it. After 10 years in the barrel, the Angels will have taken about 30% of your bourbon. Good for them.
オールドファッションなんですけれども、私はこの2つのウイスキーを混ぜて、まず初めに角砂糖とあんごしらびたずを多めに私は入れます。でそこにまあ少量のソーダを入れて、角砂糖を溶かしてまいります。でそこに氷を入れていきます。で先ほどプレミックスしたバーボンウイスキーで軽く混ぜていきます。どうぞ。オールドファッション、
in the mid-1980s, bourbon was at its lowest. Nobody wants bourbon. There was a group of guys in the bourbon industry, and they were looking for a way to revive bourbon. And it all started with a guy named Elmer T. Lee. Elmer T. Lee was the master distiller at Ancient Age.
My grandfather was here for 52 years. He and Colonel Blanton met on the riverbank behind this distillery as kids. Colonel Blanton started to work at this distillery at the age of 16. And by the time he was 35, he was the president of this distillery. During that period of time, my grandfather and Colonel Blanton had remained friends. And when Colonel Blanton started to run the distillery, he invited my grandfather to come in and work the warehouses. Because of his working in these old warehouses, Granddad discovered there were certain areas of these warehouses that had aging characteristics that produced exceptionally sweet, smooth-tasting barrels of bourbon, the honey barrel. Colonel Blanton would use those barrels of bourbon to sway political favors with the government. So Granddad was here for like 52 years with Colonel Blanton. Along comes my dad. My dad and Elmer were in the military at the same time. They became friends, and Elmer was looking for something to jumpstart the industry. Dad had learned from my grandfather where these old honey barrels were in the warehouses, and Elmer had Dad go in and pull some of those barrels. That became the taste profile of Blanton's as we know it today.
Up until this point, all bourbon was batched together. So you were seeing 100, 200 barrels mingled together to create a consistent profile. Elmer T. Lee had this idea of taking a single barrel, a honey barrel, something that was very special, had a unique profile, and showcasing just that, bottling it one at a time. In 1984, he comes out with a product that's more expensive than any other bourbon on the market, Blanton's single barrel bourbon. And that's really the shot that's heard around the world.
Jim Beam said, you know, we need to do something. But Booker didn't like single barrel because it was inconsistent. If you're doing a true single barrel, it's going to be inconsistent because it's hard to get two barrels that taste exactly alike. The way you get consistency is by mixing the barrel. So he came up with this idea of small batch.
If you make it an exclusive product, such as a small batch or a single barrel, you're creating a category that's not ordinary. You create something that will be sought after.
We've got Elmer T. Lee and Booker No working on their single barrel and small batch products. And then we see Bill Samuels of Maker's Mark and Jimmy Russell of Wild Turkey that were getting out and spreading the word. They were going to bars. They were going into, the retail shops and the restaurants and talking to people. They were sharing the stories of bourbon and their family history and making people fall in love with it.
It was a slow process, but eventually other distilleries decided they'd do a small batch or a single barrel or a special bottling. The product just started its rise.
So we started getting aficionados and old bourbon drinkers returning, all about flavor. But then we see that leap from the old guard into the new consumer, and that it happens with the bartenders.
People started, you know, playing around with how they make an old fashioned. They weren't just pulling out the old bartender's Bible and making that exact recipe. They were mixing it up a little bit, and I think it was very well received. And so when you start playing with some of these classic cocktail recipes, kind of opens the door to do different things.
When I started bartending, clear spirits, you know, dominated the back bar. Vodkas, gins, more vodkas, and a couple more vodkas. That has changed a lot over the years. Kentucky Straight Bourbon Whiskey is where it's at. It's where the excitement is.
Authentic is cool, once again. And that's come back around. We want to know where her product came from. And anything around a product's specificity does add a gravitas towards a spirit like bourbon whiskey.
I hope it's continuing to grow. If it doesn't, we're going to have a lot of bourbon on hand 8 to 10 to 12 years now, because we're making a lot of bourbon. It's 4 million people in Kentucky, and we got the bourbon distillery people has got over 6 million bourbon barrels stored right now. So we got a barrel and a half for everybody that lives in Kentucky stored right now. We cannot turn the spigot on overnight, put out a product. We've got to wait 7 to 12 years here before we can get the product to the market.
The hardest thing for any distiller is creating a new product and, you know, mashing it and then distilling it 3-4 days later and then throwing it in the barrel and then all of a sudden just, oh, I guess we'll wait and see what happens. You have to have patience.
What we're producing today, it's not available till roughly 6.5-7 years later. We're looking long range. We don't look at anything near term, because one thing we cannot do is buy time.
Bourbon cannot be rushed. It has to go in the warehouse. It has to age. People have tried to rush that process. That just can't be done.
I think there's a lot of parallels with how bourbon is made, how it's drank, how it's enjoyed, with maybe a lifestyle that we should be more pursuant of.
Bourbon will continue to evolve. Just like bourbon ages in the barrel, it's going to continue to improve and refine over time. Bourbon is eternal. Bourbon will always be in the state of Kentucky. But what bourbon looks like tomorrow will be different than what it looks like today. It's up to us to embrace that.
I'm currently putting my first batch of bourbon into these barrels. And to know that we trust the cooper that put them together, I trust the farmer that supplied our grain, I have to trust that what we've done in the distillery is enough to pull all of that together and create something beautiful at the end of the time that it takes to mature. So to think about all that it's gone through and all that we go through, there's some correlations there. You know, the sunny days and the snowy days, they all add up to be something that hopefully at the end of the road, it's really beautiful.
When Dad rolled out the 6 millionth barrel, Julian Van Winkle gave me, as a gift to my dad, this bottle of 20-year-old Pappy. So I take the bottle and I open it up, and I pour a little bit in his glass, pour a little bit in my brother's glass, pour some in my glass, and I go to put the stopper back in the bottle. And he looks at me, and he gives me this weird look, and he says, "What on earth are you doing?" I said, "Dad, I don't understand." I said, "This is a really, really good bottle of bourbon." I said, "It's really being sought after." He said, "I'm aware of that." I said, "So what I'm thinking is I'm just saving it so that we can do some more toast later on." He says, "Never, ever do that with friends and family. There will always be more old barrels of bourbon being made." He says, "Look at me and look at your brother." He says, "We're the fragile part of this whole thing." He said, "So never ever save old bottles of bourbon, okay? They're meant to be enjoyed with friends and family at the moment." It was the first time that my father and my brother and I had spent 3 hours together, just us, talking, laughing, discussing things that we had done that we didn't think he knew we had done. And then we started telling him about things that he had done that he didn't know that we knew he had done. We had the best time. We finished the bottle. 9 months later, they were both gone. It's not about the whiskey. It's about the lives you touch and the people you meet. And the whiskey is a byproduct of a good relationship. Thank you.